Who can say, I have made my heart clean, I am pure from my sin? My name's Arthur and I thank you for joining me as we share together some thoughts based on Proverbs chapter 20 and verse 9. The question, who can say, I have made my heart clean, I am pure from my sin? Those of us who've been on the road for a while know that sin clings to us. Things that we have done in the past that are wrong, we never forget them. They remain there, lurking in the background, our dirty little secrets. We don't want to tell anyone about them, but we can't clean them out. So how can we move on? Well, it's very important that we do get our heart clean. And that's what the gospel is all about. But the question of the proverb is, who can say, I have made my heart clean? I am pure from my sin. The point is that none of us can cleanse our own heart. David addresses this issue in Psalm 49, saying in verse 5, why should I fear in the days of evil, when the iniquity at my heels surrounds me? Those who trust in their wealth and boast in the multitude of their riches, none of them can by any means redeem his brother, nor give a ransom for him. For the redemption of their souls is costly, and it shall cease forever, that he should continue to live eternally and not see the pit. We cannot pay for the sins of our brother, and we cannot pay for our own sins, because the redemption of a soul is costly. In fact, it was only the Lord Jesus, who was without sin, who could lay down his life for the ransom of many. When David sinned, he sinned as we all sin, we find that he didn't offer a sacrifice, but he did call on the Lord in repentance. And we read about that in Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done this evil in your sight, that you may be found just when you speak, and blameless when you judge. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Behold, you desire truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part you will make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make my heart joy and gladness, that the bones you have broken may rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me, and do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me by your generous spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your way, and sinners shall be converted to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God, the God of my salvation. And my tongue shall sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall show forth your praise. For you do not desire sacrifice, or else I would give it. You do not delight in burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise. Do good in your good pleasure to Zion. Build the walls of Jerusalem. Then you shall be pleased with the sacrifices of righteousness, with burnt offerings and whole burnt offerings. Then you shall offer bulls on your altar. That's Psalm 51. And David acknowledges, first of all, that he was born in sin. It's his nature. And God must create in him a clean heart. He can't do that himself by sacrifices. No, he has to humble himself. A broken and a contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise. And when our fellowship with God is restored through humility, then we can offer him the praise and sacrifices of righteousness, living a life that gives glory to him. This theme of us needing cleansing occurs right through Scripture. In Isaiah chapter 1, we read, "Wash yourselves, make yourselves clean. Put away the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil, learn to do good, seek justice, rebuke the oppressor, defend the fatherless, plead for the widow. Come now and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the good of the land. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured by the sword. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken." Again, the Lord is calling people, first of all, to recognize their sinfulness, to turn away from that and come to the Lord, that they might find reconciliation with Him, that He might deal with their sin, and that He might save them and bless them in the land. Jeremiah speaks to the children of Israel again about the wickedness of their heart. In chapter 17, verse 9, "The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I test the mind, even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings." Our natural inclination is to do evil, but the Lord wants to change our heart, create a new heart in me. "Wash me and I shall be clean," as David said. And our proverb is saying, "Who can say, I have made my heart clean? I am pure from my sin." The only one who can say that is the one who has been washed by the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the wonderful declaration of the New Testament, that it is only in the name of Jesus, by this man, that we preach the forgiveness of sin. For the blood of bulls and goats offered in the Old Testament could never take away sin. They were a sacrifice of an animal. But Jesus bore our sin in his own body on the tree. And so John, in his first epistle, writes, "This is the message which we have heard from him and declare to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us." What John is emphasizing is that we are all sinful, and God's remedy for sin is the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. When that blood is applied to our lives, then we can walk in the light, not boasting of our own righteousness, but claiming the righteousness that is in Christ. "For he who knew no sin was made sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." The way forward is simple. Humble ourselves before God. Confess our sin and our sins. That is, we are sinful. We are selfish. We are self-centered. We are proud. And therefore, we do sins. We do things that are wrong. We fall short of the standard of God. We do not walk as we should. But by drawing near to Jesus Christ and confessing our sins, we can walk in the light. We let his light shine on us and show us the things that are wrong, so that we turn away from evil and do that which is good. For that's the exhortation of the Scriptures for those who are believers, that we've had enough time in the past before we believed, walking in the ways of the flesh. Now we are called to walk by the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. Who can say, I have made my heart clean, I am pure from my sin? The redemption of a soul is costly. The price has been paid by Jesus Christ, and the promise is, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. Be saved.